Ghost Rider. Dro Pesci. Yeah, 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 yeah. Hey, what's up, y'all? It's Brother Dave. It's a beautiful day. I want to say God is good. Listen, I just want to encourage you today. Yesterday, it's gone. You're never getting it back. Yesterday is gone forever. Tomorrow is not promised. So what we have left is today. We need to focus on the gift that God has given us with today, and what are we going to do with today? Remember, each day is a gift of God. Tomorrow is not promised. Yesterday is gone forever. Focus on today and the gift of the day and life that God has given you right now. Use it wisely. Use it to draw closer to the Lord and to be better than you were yesterday. God bless you all. Remain strong. Keep strong in the Lord and continue to grow in the ways of the Lord. For life is but a vapor. We're here one day. We're gone the next. Use today wisely, y'all. God bless.
David Novinsky, how are you, brother?
Hey, what's going on, Steph? How you doing?
Not much. I'm really excited to have you on this first show on Romans 1:16 Ministries, and I just want to introduce everyone else to you, because ever since I first heard your music, you write hip-hop and rap Christian lyrics, and it's some of the most uplifting and inspiring Christian music that I've found personally, so it's an honor to have you on the show. I appreciate you talking to me.
Hey, praise God, praise God. I appreciate being here. I'm glad you had me. Started a ministry called Crosstown Ministries, where we bring the message of the cross to surrounding towns, and hopefully one day, you know, God willing, we'll be able to bring the message all across the United States, and that's the mission. That's what we're working towards, and we do it through music and preaching, and along the way, we make sure that we help people find a place to get, you know, involved in so they can be discipled, because we believe that discipleship is one of the most important things that is being overlooked today. In today's evangelism or today's Christianity, there's a lot of evangelizing, but there's not a lot of discipleship. So we want to focus on discipleship, this ministry. I mean, it's just me by myself, but there's other people in different areas that get involved, like from the event coordinators to the ones that bring me out to the events, you know, from the churches that call me up and invite me out to speak. You know, we get other people involved along the way.
That's awesome. You've been doing a lot of public speaking and evangelism lately, and the last time that you and I were on the phone, you remember this, the Holy Spirit kind of took over your voice, and you really started ministering. And does that happen all the time when you do public speaking, or?
It depends. I mean, if I'm just speaking, you know, from myself, no. I mean, if I'm going there to deliver a message, if I'm going there to bring the gospel, or if I'm going there to preach a sermon, or I'm going there to speak on something specifically, then, yeah, you know, the Holy Spirit will always be there with us, you know, for those who are born again, I should say, because we can never forget that, you know, John chapter 3, verse 3 says that unless a man be born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. So that's why I'm so adamant on discipleship, because we have a lot of sinner's prayers being said, you know, with half-hearted confessions. You know, it's not a true repentance. It's not a, you know, it's not a true breaking of the power of God. You know, it says in John 6:44 that nobody can come to the Son unless the Father draws them. So, you know, we got a lot of people that want to join the Christian club, but they're not, you know, their heart isn't in it. As Jesus said, many profess me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. You know, we got to make sure that the people that are, you know, interested in knowing Jesus are coming from, you know, the drawing of the Holy Spirit, and we can help them, you know, invite Christ into their life and train them on how to pick up their cross and follow after the Lord, because that's what it's all about, true conversions.
That's right. You speak the truth, brother. And I kind of want to ask you, because this is something kind of personal that's been going on in my life, but I think many other Christians can relate to it. You know, we come to God, of course, because the Holy Spirit draws us there. And, you know, in my life, in my testimony, I accepted Christ when I totally just was angry at the world, gave it all up, and just was heartbroken. You know, I never entered into his presence through religion or anything like that. It was just a true relationship that began, you know, with God through Christ.
Well, do you notice?
Spirit.
You notice you said the key factor right there. You entered in through a true brokenness, and that
right.
goes back That's, to my point. That goes back to my point of true repentance. You can't really have a true repentance if you're not broken. You know that the old saying is so true. You know, sometimes God takes you to rock bottom, so you find out that He is the rock at the bottom. That is a very
right.
true statement. You know, it's a lot of people.
That just makes me want to jump up and down and say amen. That is so true.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, it's very simple. You know, we're supposed to come to the Lord with childlike faith. You know, the Lord seeks after our hearts, even though in Jeremiah 17:9 that it says our hearts are deceitfully wicked. You know, the Lord knows if our innermost being is truly desiring Him. And I believe that if a heart is true to seek after the Lord, the Bible says that if you follow after the Lord and seek Him and walk in His ways and you develop faith, that He will send the Comforter. And, you know, that's how I believe you get born again, by truly seeking after the Lord. You know, it's, again, a simple saying. Knock and the door shall be answered. Seek and you shall find. You know, if the heart is genuine and it's truly seeking the Lord, I think the Lord takes notice of that. And, you know, of course we go through trials and stuff, and we don't always get born again right away. You know, I made a profession to Christ, but it wasn't maybe several months after before the Holy Spirit fell on me. So, you know, I hear that a lot in people. It's not like an instant, you know, for some people it's an instant conversion, and some people it's not. You know, when they go up there and they fall before their face and accept the Lord, it's a seed that's been planted, you know, and then the Lord tests them. Is their faith going to be genuine? Are they truly going to seek Him? You know, when He sees their heart is right, you know, I believe that's when He sends the Holy Spirit on them, and that's when I believe He saves them.
That is so right. And it, you know, me, like many other people, just came to Him through a broken heart. And I think there's a lot of brokenness going on right now, like including in my own life. There's just things that I don't understand, and I tend to, and then you have the enemy coming against you, and then, you know, you feel like you're falling away from the Lord. But the beautiful thing about a true Christian, you know, a true Christian in our relationship with God, is that He will never, ever, ever leave people. And that's really what I want to encourage people today. I'm not preaching a hyper-grace gospel. I believe in the Bible and the Word and true repentance of our sins. But I also know that Christianity is a process. It is a pruning process. I know this because I've been walking through it for only 2 years now, and some would consider me a baby Christian. But, you know, and I don't know theology and everything about doctrines and stuff like that, but I do know the Lord, and I do know that through all of my stumbling.
let me give you something real quickly that you just touched on. That knowing theology, knowing the Bible in and out, you know, that's great to have knowledge, but at the end of the day, knowledge has never saved anyone. It's always been relationship, and it's always been that true heart after the Lord. The Bible is clear and says that the Lord will use the foolish to shame the wise. You see, the Pharisees knew the Word front to back. The Pharisees knew the Word completely up to down, and they missed Jesus right in front of them. You know, it's good to have knowledge. It's good to have knowledge. It's good to have wisdom, and the Bible is a lifelong revelation. You know, we'll learn. You can read the Bible front to back 20 times and learn something new every time. That's not solely what it's about. What it's about solely is allowing the Lord, coming to the end of yourself and surrendering you over to the Lord. You know, the Bible says in Philippians 2:12-13, it says you have to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But if you go into the very next verse, it says it is God who works in us to do His will and good pleasure. So when you come to the end of yourself and you truly mean it inside your heart to give it to the Lord, learn about the Lord, seek after the Lord, walk with the Lord, He's going to help you.
That's right. Amen. And one touch of Christ is worth every struggle in the world. So I'm not saying this out of complaint. I'm just saying this out of truth.
Right.
Once I came to, you know, because I came out of paganism and the occult for 12 years, and no one said a word to me. No one said anything to me. It was fine that I was practicing witchcraft and being a psychic medium. But I'm telling you, the second that I surrendered to Christ and gave my life to God and gained the Holy Spirit, the whole world came against me, it felt like.
Yes,
you know, all of a sudden nobody wants to hear me preaching about spirituality no more. I'm so thankful to God for giving me this radio show today, because it's like all a true Christian wants people to know. They don't understand. We're not throwing religion in your face. We want you to know God. We want you to know His love, and that's where we're coming from. And
that's right.
I've just been told lately, all these atheists and non-believers and stuff, and I'm not here to judge nobody, but I'm tired of them telling me to be quiet. Why in the world should the world be allowed to, you know, glorify everything that Satan's doing, but, you know, in the New Age and everyone else wants to coexist with everyone except for Christians? And I'm so grateful to God for giving people, you know, His people a voice to just share the good news, because that's really all where we're coming from. You know, we're not trying to, we can't convert people. Only the Holy Spirit can convert people. But,
you know, you just hit the nail on the head. I mean, it's very simple. You know, God draws the person with His Holy Spirit. The person has a choice to you know, follow that draw or reject it and go their own way. You know, God does not force us to himself. He will draw us in. He will do that. He will, you know, supersede our free will in order to work in our hearts, in order to make himself be known to us and to give us that option of taking him or going our own way. He will interfere with our free will in that sense. You know, and if there's no denying it, I mean, like the Bible says, every man will be held without excuse. But what I'm getting at is God is not going to force anybody. And it's, you know, it's when he steps in and draws you in, you know, are you going to accept it or not? And when you become a Christian, the hardest thing to realize is that the world is going to be against you. Because the world is still
exactly
the world is still in what they call a spiritual darkness. They are still veiled. Right. 2 Corinthians 4:4 says that if the gospel be hidden, it is hidden unto those who are still blinded. You see, well, when God works, like he worked on your heart, he worked on my heart, he worked on many people's hearts that are listening today, you know, as he worked in our hearts, he started to remove that veil, and we started to be able to recognize him, because the Bible says that none are righteous, that none seek after God. We all go after our own sinful, wicked ways, and that's just the way it is, because that is the veil that has been over us, you know, from the curse of sin. So until God starts to lift that veil, you know, one is really going to be just like, so not open to it, you know, and it's just, that's why God says, you know, you don't know who he's going to save. You don't know who he's going to draw. We go out, Matthew 28:20 says to go out, preach the gospel unto every creature, you know, baptize people in the name of Jesus Christ and plant the seed and let the Holy Spirit do his job, you know, but we got to be bold enough to not back down to the world when they say, we don't want your Jesus. You know, but we got to be bold enough to, I mean, I know Christians today that this is what I want to encourage anybody listening that is a born again believer. You know, there's Christians today that they go in their workplace or they go in their hobbies or their weekend locations, and they know in their heart they want to speak up about Christ, but they keep their mouth shut because they don't want to feel like they're putting it on somebody, or they don't want to interrupt the vibe of the place or whatever they call it. But see, Jesus said that if you deny me before men, I will also deny you before my Father. If one has a truly close relationship with the Lord, they will not be ashamed to speak up for their Lord. We are saved to serve. We have to just preach the gospel. We have to preach the gospel, and we can't worry about, you know, making the increase. We can just plant seeds and water seeds. That's all we can do.
That's right. That's right. And let the Holy Spirit take over and do its job. It's so refreshing talking to you.
And it takes a lot of time for discovery. You know, they always say iron sharpens iron. So just as the Bible never forsakes the gathering of the saints. So, you know, we shouldn't forsake our churches. I see a lot of people telling people to come out of the church, come out of the church. Well, you know, even though it is true that the devil is involved in many churches, you know, there is a church on every corner practically, and no, they're not all correct. What I'm saying is use the God-given ability to you know, use your instinct, use the Holy Spirit to find a, you know, discernment, to find a church home where you can grow. Because this is when you come to the cross of Christ, and you surrender your life, everything is fine right away. But the days to come after that will be the hardest you've ever had to face. Because in that time period, the devil comes. It says, if you read the parable of the soils, it says that once the seed starts to sprout, the devil will come and try to rip it out of you. So if you're not around believers, if you're not in the Word, if you're not putting yourself around others who have been there, done that, you really don't have much covering. And the devil will have a field day with you, and soon before you know it, you are all a Christian all of a sudden, and a month later, now you're back in the world, back on drugs, back doing that. You just gave up.
That's
why the discipleship is so important, because in this ministry, what I'm doing here is we're gonna teach people how to get in the Word, how to make time for God, how to, you know, basically to put God first and put your schedule around God instead of putting your schedule first and trying to fit God into your schedule.
Amen.
It says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You know, God made Christ to be sin who knew no sin for us. You see, so that's what holds the body of Christ together. And Romans 12:4 says that we are all many different members made up of one body. You know, for what can the hand do without the foot, the eye without the ear? We're all different pieces to this puzzle. And God distributes his giftings, you know, the spiritual giftings, he distributes them throughout the body of Christ. For example, you may have You know, you may dream dreams and have visions. You may have prophecy. I don't, you know, I may have only been given the ability to have wisdom and discernment and to teach the Bible. You know, that it's just, we got to take what God gives us and we have to cultivate those gifts. You know, we should always seek for more gifts if it be God's will, but we have to remember that no servant is above his master. So whatever God distributes to you, you just kind of cultivate it and run with it and be the best you can with it. I mean, it doesn't matter if you're Billy Graham in an arena preaching to 30,000 or you're, you know, Miss Betty in the church on Sunday bringing coffee and donuts in to make sure people got some little snacks and you know, she shares a good encouraging word.
Everybody matters. We end up touching people in ways that we don't even realize, you know. I mean, honestly, like some of the most effective Christians that were in my life while I was in the occult were kind of like Miss Betty. They were the people that just kind of, you know, hey, honey, and they were just genuine, loving characters and loved me anyways and never shoved anything down my throat, but they led by example, and you could just tell that there was something different in that Christian. You could just tell that they had some kind of just supernatural love in them because there's no other way to understand true love and true coexisting with the world and the people and everything that any person, any human deals with. There's no way to truly cope with it and know the absolute truth unless you know the sovereign God through Jesus Christ. And that's just that's the commonality and that's the truth that Christians have found, and that's the message that we want to get out there. And I appreciate you doing that through your music and through your ministry. Tell me more about, you have a new album out, huh?
Yes, I do. I just got a brand new album just came out. It's actually the official release date is going to be this Saturday. Took a bunch of pre-orders. Yeah, I named it Psalms 91. If you guys aren't familiar with Psalms 91, you know, you should check it out. There's a lot of great promises for those who trust in Christ, you know, and are walking after the Lord and have truly accepted, you know, Jesus as their Savior. Psalms 91 is full of promises, encouragement. It's full of, you know, it's just full of God's love as well. And I named it Psalms 91 because I want people to understand, especially I don't know what, you know, what God has planned for the future, but for right now, God is using Crosstown Ministries to minister to those who have just recently came to the cross. And it's a pretty much like a stepping stone to help the younger Christian grow into that next level of maturity. So, you know, I want to get a lot of people involved in Psalms 91 because, you know, after reading that personally myself over and over and over and when I started to really understand it, you know, it really broke away some of that deception that the enemy brings and all the stuff that the world throws at you. I mean, if you can learn to truly lean on the rock, which is Christ, and you can learn to truly trust in God, you know, Psalms 91 is a beautiful chapter of the Bible that brings courage, strength, and it basically eliminates fear. And that's a big thing because, you know, the devil uses fear just so immensely against the new Christian, you know, fear of, you know, what denomination is right, what doctrine is right, what this is right, what that's right, what's this, what's that. And they get so confused. You know, that's the biggest game of the enemy is fear and confusion. So, you know, I try to get people to soak in Psalms 91 so they can kind of combat the fear and confusion.
That's awesome. And
when you're in God's will, he makes the way. That's one thing Christians have, especially new Christians, they have a big issue with, well, what's God's will? Well, what's this? Well, what's that? You know, I'm only in for 3 years, and I can tell you just with a little bit of experience that I have, that God's will in the beginning is simply for you to come out of the world, to get along with him, to apply his word to your life, to seek him out. You know, it's even as simple as, see, people like to complicate things. If you're a new Christian, it's as simple as just getting along with God. Okay, when you used to go to the gym for 2 hours or you used to go meet this friend or meet that friend, cancel those things out. Spend an hour a day with God. You know, when you start out, spend an hour a day with God. Read the word, pray, and speak to him like he's sitting there with you. Let him share your heart with him, you know?
That's right. Cast your cares
on him. Open up the relationship. Yeah, open up the relationship and spend time with God. And in the beginning, it's not, God's will is not going to be revealed to us, boom, all on, just here it is, follow after me. No, it's a trial and error thing. You know, we have to pray about it. We have to follow the Spirit. We have to listen for God's voice. You know, so many people are quick to pray, and then they're out the door. It's just like, it's like a quick ritual they do, but they never are patient. They never are still. You know, it says, be still and know that I am God. Like when you're praying like that, pray and wait for God to answer. If he doesn't answer, okay, then keep it moving. But a lot of people get in the habit of saying a quick prayer and then boom, they're out the door. They're on their way to work. They're doing this. They're doing that.
That's
they never
right.
give
maybe,
God. a chance to respond.
You know, we're not supposed to shut our convictions up. We're not supposed to shut the Holy Spirit up. We're supposed to speak out and spread the gospel like you're doing. So I'm really, really proud of you,
exactly.
And I'm really blessed to have you on the show today. Like,
and another thing Christians need to learn is that love is never defined as tolerance of wickedness. A lot of Christians today are being taught that love is an automatic tolerance, like you said, the coexisting or the...
I can't stand it. They want to push their beliefs in my face, and I get it. I was in the New Age. I understand your lies and your deceit that you believe. I get it. But why are they telling us to be quiet? Because the Holy Spirit speaks the truth, and it convicts people. That's not us condemning people or judging people. We have no right to do that. We know we're wretched sinners saved by grace.
Well, we know who we are. Just to back up the statement that we both just made, if you look in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, it says that God has not called us to uncleanness, but unto holiness. Therefore, if somebody despises you, it is God who they despise and not you.
That's right. And that's what I've been dealing with lately. People who are like, oh, you're a great person. I like being around you, Stephanie, until you talk about God. And, oh, you talk about God all the time. Where I'm like, well, go away then. Go away from me, because I don't know what else to say. I'm not going to back down on my faith or my beliefs. You know, as a Christian, I don't pretend to be holier than thou, because God knows that I am not.
Wow.
I am in this pruning process, but my heart is with
the Lord. Well, anybody who claims to be a Christian and cannot openly admit that they fail God at some point is probably not a true Christian.
A liar.
Because
exactly. Anyone who says they're not, they don't sin, they're a liar.
Exactly.
You know?
They don't understand that it's not, you know, when you do walk in the newness of life. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, you know, for the old man is gone, and anybody in Christ walks in the newness of life. Yes, that is the process we speak of. That is, you know, the maturity process, the sanctification, and all, and just God working in you to kind of straighten you out. You know, it takes time, and it's a process, and we will never finish this process fully until we're with the Lord and we get our glorified body. So anybody who tells you that, you know, Christ gave you some kind of power to become sinless is just completely lost, or they're following seducing spirits, because that's not, you know, if Christ did not come to die to give us the power to be Christ, Christ came to die because we could not be Christ, you see?
That's right. Exactly. That's exactly right.
So, you know, the enemy uses subtle twists. He uses subtle twists and turns, and it's just we just knock him out. We just knock him out with the word itself, and anybody who can't
stand
on the word, it's just, you know, they got some growing to do. And it's not really hard, because the Lord speaks over and over and over again about, you know, likening ourselves unto a child. You know, he tells the when the apostle said, Lord, what must we do to be the greatest in heaven? Or, you know, they said, who is the greatest in heaven? And the Lord pulled over the little child, and he said, listen, unless you liken yourselves unto this child, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. See, what that's telling us is that God, when we come to Christ and we become born again, God becomes our spirit. He's our father. He's our spiritual father, and we are his children, and we should honor him and respect him as our father. And that's what that childlike faith is about. Any Christian running around trying to act like he's Jesus and he's got problems, you know, God's going to humble him real quick, because, you know, I believe in my heart of hearts that God would rather you be a heroin addict than a spiritual, prideful person.
That's right, because pride is what got Lucifer kicked out of heaven in the first place.
There you go.
That's so right, you know, and it's something that I've been, the devil, I mean, I'm not even around that many people in my everyday life, but the devil's constantly doing mind warfare on me, and it's like, you know, for a long time he tried to make me feel like I couldn't go to God, or I should feel condemned or guilty about this, but there's a difference between feeling condemned and feeling convicted, you know.
Conviction,
and God,
right.
Yeah, God always wants, I just want to tell people, God, no matter where you're at in life right now, no matter who you are, where you're at, what you've done, what you haven't done, go to God in Jesus' name. That's why Jesus came, so you could reconcile with the Father. Like, Jesus' blood is powerful, and go to God. Pray without ceasing, and just have that relationship with God, and forget about what the world's telling you, because the world is one big lie right now, in my opinion. but the only truth and the only absolute truth I've ever found in my life was through Jesus Christ and
the
Word.
Well, that's, you know, and that's what I was going to touch on, because the Christianity message today is, come to God and he'll bless you, he'll take care of you, he'll prosper you, he'll give you health and wealth and shiny white teeth.
No, what we got to do
is give people the word of God, which is, we are all dead in sin, we are all on our way to hell, we are all in need of a savior, and if we don't have payment or reconciliation for this sin nature, then we will fall short of the presence of God if we are not in Christ. We are all sinners. We are all on our way to hell. We are. That's it. And we need a Savior. We need to give them the real gospel message of why Christ came, and to run around and evangelize and tell people that come to God and He'll bless you and prosper you. How can God prosper you in a world that He tells you to come out of?
That's right. It's so contradictory. And these people have massive amount of congregation sitting there listening to their bull crap, and that's all
about
it is bull crap.
Well, I look at it this way. Those type of people, you know, a lot of them are probably genuine, and a lot of them are growing. They just don't know
that's
any better,
right.
Or, you know, it could be the areas that could be their only church that they have for right now. But, you know, there's a lot of people in there that are growing, and they are becoming real Christians, and they are getting born again. But then there's a lot of people that are just following, you know, deceitfully. And
the prosperity gospel, God, yes, God blesses you, but we got to be obedient to God.
Right.
Period. You know, it doesn't
come
without.
Even then, there's no guarantee that you'll be blessed, and a blessing doesn't even equal you know, world prosperity or world gain or financial gain.
Exactly, a blessing was waking up this morning and being able to breathe.
Exactly.
You know?
Can God bless you with money? Absolutely. Can God increase your business? Absolutely. Can God increase your territory? Absolutely. God can do whatever He wants, but these people make it sound like it's the standard, when in reality it's pretty much the exception. You know, like I said, the different giftings, not everyone is going to be blessed in the same way. Not everyone is going to be called to the same thing. So if you're preaching a message that preaches that all will prosper, all will become healthy, that's not true. See, the real gospel message is that because of sin, because of the Garden of Eden, we all are susceptible to sickness, illness, and disease, and we all will suffer. You know, every major person of the Bible suffered. Paul suffered.
Yes.
Peter suffered. Yes. James suffered. Isaiah suffered. Jeremiah suffered. Ezekiel suffered. They all suffered. Moses, Job, they all suffered. That's prosperity was birthed out of some lie. They created a new Jesus. It doesn't even matter. The point is that we've got to stand on the Word. What does the Word say? Forget how man tells it to you.
I preach Christ crucified. That's what it says.
Exactly.
It says,
and when Paul
Christ
said, if any man or an angel or an angel, it seems that an angel from heaven appears to bring you another gospel, let them be accursed. Stick to the gospel that the apostles delivered.
That's right. It's simple. The preaching of Christ is very simple. It's all about Jesus and keeping your focus on Him. It's not a brainwashing. It's being renewed by the transforming of your mind, by getting the
That's
Word
right.
in you and in your spirit, because it enables you, it equips you to fight this battle that once you become a Christian, if you didn't know already, you learn that you're in a spiritual battle on this planet. It is literally God versus Satan. It's been like this since the beginning.
You become the light, so naturally the darkness is going to hate you.
Oh, yeah, and you'll be attacked, I promise. I've been going through it for 2 years, but, you know, I keep growing, and what I'm so grateful for is just standing on God's promises. He has never once left me, not once.
And that's a true test of faith, because in the prosperity gospel, they'll say, well, if any of you get sick, you know, just give it to God and have faith, and He'll heal you. Well, there's plenty of devout Christians that never do get healed, but you know what they do? They stick to their faith regardless of their situation. And even if the cancer kills them, even if the cancer kills them slowly, what they don't do is they don't ever lose hope in God. They don't ever let go of Christ or the hope of Christ. And even though that cancer gets them, their real life truly begins when this life ends.
That's right. It's all about eternity. What is this life when it's so short compared to eternity? And that's what Christians, you know, that's what I'm convicted by even saying this. I need to keep my mind on things of the kingdom and not of this world, because our reward is in the afterlife. You know, it's not cars and money and worldly stuff and fame and all that nonsense in this world that obviously tears people apart once they get it. It's like, why would you really even want that? So it's
God will bless people to be a blessing. You know, God say,
totally.
You know, say God calls you in. God calls you into the workplace, and you know He gives you a pathway to increase you in whatever it is you do. Let's say you're an electrician or you're a house builder, or you know God can use you to prosper you, make you very, very, very rich. But I don't think God's going to do that to somebody that He doesn't know or foreseen that could handle that type of responsibility. Like, He will bless people to be a blessing. He's not going to bless
people.
That's
the key word right there, to be a blessing to other people. That's right.
He's not going to bless people just so they can become super rich and become selfish and, not right. help the kingdom. No, that's not what's going to happen. God is going to bless a vessel that he has foreseen to be able to handle that responsibility.
That's right.
That's like with me. Yeah. God could never make me rich. God could never give me $20 million and expect me to be a good and faithful servant because
yeah,
I
me
might,
either.
You know, I just know that I'm not equipped to handle $20 million without following after the lures of the world. Some people, they got it in them. You know, the Holy Spirit distributes that service gift. You know, it's like a servant's
right.
heart. And some people, you know, some people come to the Lord, they have to suffer. Some suffer, some prosper. You know, the blessings, the rain falls on the just and the unjust. All it's about
right.
is the relationship and being content. Like Apostle Paul said, I have to learn to be content with much and content with little at the same time.
That's right. Contentment is great gain. Definitely. It really is. And that's just what I want to spread to people that maybe know Christ or maybe not know Christ. Christianity is not about us. It's not. It's about Jesus. It's about him.
Exactly.
Because
I would tell anybody,
oh my God.
anybody who just totally rejects the idea of God or Christ or the Bible or anything, you know, I tell them two simple things. Number one, you had no control over even coming here, and you have no control over when you're leaving here. So just by you being able to look at the fact that you have zero control is a wake up that something is bigger than you. Okay. And the second thing I tell them is every opponent to the Bible has outlived all of its opposition. Though the people that came against the Bible all throughout history have died and gone, yet the Bible still remains. Nothing can destroy it. Nothing can get rid of it, and nothing can defeat it. That
right.
is a supernatural, powerful book that cannot be touched. I mean, you really think about it. If the Bible was that big of a joke, couldn't somebody just get rid of it? Couldn't they just stop
that's
printing
right.
it?
That's right. You know, that's the main question that actually brought me to studying the history about the Bible. Like, right the week before I got saved, a red flag went up in my head. I was studying all the New World Order and Illuminati stuff and all the elite, and I was sitting there questioning. I said, well, if Jesus Christ and the Bible wasn't real, why in the world are the Satanist occultist elite of the UN and every other powerful organization that's involved with the Illuminati, why in the world are they worried about it?
Why do they even care? Right.
Really appreciate you coming on the show. So thank you so much, David, for coming on the show with me. I really appreciate talking to you. It's been very edifying for me to talk to you. So I hope the listeners gain that as well. But thank you so much.
God bless you, Stephanie. Thanks for having me. Take orders from no tyrant. I'm defying a giant larger than Leviathan, born in a lion's den, informed by the might within. I am him, he is me, Diesel, I'm the G-O-D, the energy in everything and everyone you'll ever see. We are all connected by a higher power. It's time that we unite and fight until the final hour. Ghost Rider, Steve Grant, Diesel, we unite. Uniting tyrants, we divide. Peacefully, we freedom fighting. The lyrics we recite and all the weapons that we choose. If the people